describe a tree at night. To stand under a circle of trees. To stand beneath the infinite algebra of dreams. To be spiked on the logic of language, of failure and of loss. Leaves brush my face as I pass on inwards. Trees are like inverted lungs and I breathe in. Traffic is like a procession of ants, but without ants' purpose. The shriek of geese, the calligraphy of branches, white writing against the sky, the slight falling in of dead leaves in spring. I stand under a circle of trees and breathe the lungs of the earth. For how much longer will this last? Is this how I can best describe a tree at night? As if I stand in front of foxgloves and they are taller than myself. Yes. This is my body. Yes. The one that is dissolved in sap. Yes. This is my heart growing from inscribed valves. And I shall watch the kaleidoscope of my grated leaves. And I should reckon on the silence of our mouths of muted speech. There had always been horses on the island. Calm, dappled horses that stood in perfect stillness for half hours or hours on the sands at the sea's edge. Waiting for the subtle and delicate waviness of the shifting breeze, their bellies reflected in the wet sand. Horses that waited in the shape of distant islands, or on the short headlands of schist, cropping grasses from among the moss. Horses that in winter walked the solid ice of the shattered land, crossing from lake to lake and crest to crest, across a land that was solidified time. And that in spring and early spring, I always think of moorland like the railways around here. And that in spring and early summers pulled up every furrow there was room for, and that later carried the rise to the moor edge mills, horses that came down from the mountains, small and discerning and wiry, horses that were quite uncompromised, but that would become fastidious if left in the easy meadows too long. Blue horses whose blood must be milk. Blue horses with translucent bellies lit up by the sun. Mares with white blue fetuses floating upside down beside them. Horses that in winter walk along snow rocks and think about pain. And in autumn stand on rock crests to watch brown days sink away. Horses that stood against gales and the pelting of hail. And when the roofs of houses and barns would be torn off. Horses that in snowfalls would stand on the gable ends or in hollows on the lee sides. And then the horses of chance, the blue horses, change and become red. Red translucent bellies x-rayed in the sun. Translucent red-edged fetuses swimming in dark dreams. And then those terrible mornings, those dawns when it seemed that the bellies of horses had been ripped open. And the waters of life gushed over the earth's surface, and the horses with their muzzles agape and their bloodshot eyes, and the gentle eyes of the horses that come along the sea. In the background of a cafe, five or six men talking around a table, Yiddish probably. Beyond the rows of donuts and strudel that form sort of channel thing, a sort of light tongue for their passage. They resemble beggars, and they resemble people who always give to beggars, whatever their means, and it's scant. One of the beggars says, it's against the law to beg. I think, what is the law, is we all live together. In the backgrounds of language, there where all of us have congregated for centuries, in the cafe off the market with the widest pavements of the city, opposite the hospital since all of us fear we must go there at some time. And years later I do go there, but inside I make a painting with many layers and surfaces, and I write on the surfaces, together with poems and fragments in many languages, Bangla and Turkish, Somali and English, Urdu, let's say Nazrul, let's say Oktay, let's say Ganyan, let's say Blake, let's say Fez. And I write into the painting. Translation is a vital art, words translated through the heart. And then I walk out into the sunlight, and indeed the sun's light is an unbelievable pleasure. Indeed, translation is a vital art. Indeed, I am happy to walk here with all my fellow beggars in a marvelous festival of beggar. I'm not on the lake. I'm standing there on my uppers, under the blue. Then I kick out and I'm flying. This is how it would have to be. This is the beginning and the end. The ease of life is caved in. This is the open definition of freedom. This is the absence of that constriction. This is the tricky numbness of dizzy height. This is where the inner stairway collapses in on the same self. This is the beginning of ending. This is the start of calm zero. These are blue beads of time defined in translation. This is the edge of the world, and this is its wonder and beauty. August sun passes gradually. August and northern sun. Snow curling down the pine spurs, sowing wet dust into the nervous spruce. The next day we drove high into Paso de Gallia along ice wraiths and raw surfaces to the bite of blue and white lakes. The leaves were reading this poem, but not using words. Wearing his boots and my coat hung off, my white vest loosened to the still blue, I ran stomping my footprints in the snow, up to the blue glaze of the sun's dead eye, high into the silent place of light and air, until a sudden edge would plunge me off. And then I turned and walked slowly back down my footmarks to where the streams were turning into water, to the standing trees. And on the other side was Tres Niñoy, and its plumed cornice in the silence of hawks. We had grappa and salami at the ice age. My mother played here 60 years ago, and partisans with guns down in the war. Then we drove back the long way around on the above ravines, where Giacomo used to herd sheep as a child on the other side, and in a great view we got back to the Pineta. We went down 3,000 meters in a short hour, and it broke open memory and passed us through air starts of dead language and unremitted congestion of stretched time. Our minds fell into that glacier and were only spat out those thousands of years later. I had tried to assassinate my own tongue, and I had not managed it yet. And the photographs were took there of me with your father and Luigi and Emil have disappeared in the months of brown time. And there was another bounded by snowfields at the end of a fire of red spruce. and inside the library there was a golden book. There were a few lines missing from it. They are in the back of some screen exercise book. The island man had faith in this, in the existence of both the library and the book, of more than one library and more than one book, of a room filled by such books. He knew it was there, in the heat of the suns, in the clarity of cold moorlands, that it would come slanting down with closed eyes, that it would shine there deliberately and quietly, unfeigning and with imperturbable strength. There was peace in that moment, peace without dust, and the rich energies of achievement without oppression, the geometry of motion without frenetic activity. There was a wall without a door, and yet we could pass through it with the light. Strange architects seemed not to know how it was thought. And it smelt of sweet corn washing laid out of the leaves to dry. Theory of getting beyond the limits, antithesis of defending the territory, power of the powerless, frail remnant, the centres of the world being its edges, the calms of the periphery. There's a library on the other side of the world. Wherever you are, it is always there.